Tantor Audio presents Labor Day, True Birth Stories by Today's Best Women Writers. Edited by Eleanor Henderson and Anna Solomon. Narrated by Cris Dukehart and Hilary Huber. Introduction. Expect the unexpected. Angelina and Giselle prepared their tubs. Christina Aguilera scheduled an elective C-section. Kate Middleton broke ground by asking her prince to stay in the delivery room instead of heading to the links. As choices of when, where, and how to give birth have become more numerous and more stark, American mothers are preparing for labor with one common thing in their diaper bags: birth plans. Such plans have become as ubiquitous as stretch mark creams and layettes, and as the first decision many make as parents, they're charged with meaning. What began as an expression of personal preference has quickly come to represent a declaration of our philosophies, our politics, and our identities, as mothers and as women. The story of birth in the 21st century is undeniably different from the one it was 30 years ago, when what to expect when you're expecting first empowered mothers-to-be with essential guidance through the 40 weeks of pregnancy. Since then, thousands of new books and documentaries and articles and blogs have sought to prepare women for the final push of pregnancy, their Labor Day. A vast and diverse industry has grown up around birth in the United States, from boutique labor and delivery suites that offer mani-pedis and vaginal rejuvenation therapies, to alternative birthing centers that provide the chance to labor without drugs or medical intervention. A generation ago, many of our mothers went into the hospital with a comb and nightgown. We go in armed with our birthing ball and pump, our iPod loaded with rainforest sounds. They took a Lamaze class, maybe. We take classes in breastfeeding and infant care and prenatal yoga, where we do our Kegel exercises in obedient unison. As often as not, they expected to birth on their backs, with their husbands cheering them on from the hallway, or the nearest bar. We, on the other hand, are encouraged by doctors and co-workers, family and friends, to tackle our labors as we might a new job, to make detailed birth plans, to hire doulas who will advocate for these plans, to train our partners as our coaches and cord cutters. Oh, and do we want that cord to be cut right away or after it has stopped pulsing? Do we want eye ointment administered? Do we want to delay the first bath? With these choices comes information, a tidal wave of statistics and warnings, often contradictory, sometimes frightening, always addictive. On the one hand, many doctors won't allow patients to attempt a vaginal birth after having had a C-section, VBAC, and warn that going beyond 41 weeks or having a larger baby endangers our babies and us. On the other hand, natural birth advocates warn that epidurals will lead to Pitocin, which will lead to other interventions, that C-sections cause infection, and that episiotomies are akin to genital mutilation. Today, many Western women are told they can have babies well into their 40s, yet anyone over 35 still falls into advanced maternal age and is encouraged to undergo extra tests, which bring added anxiety. Armed with all this information, with countless choices, with squat bars and whirlpool tubs and walking epidurals, we are meant to feel empowered. We enter a heady zone of birth preparation. Here, it seems, we can bring the uncontrollable under our control, but often our plans prove somewhere in between irrelevant and useless. Angelina never got to use that birthing tub. When her baby presented breech, she had a C-section. For the lucky few, birth goes beautifully. Short, free of complication, perhaps even sublime. More commonly, our labors tackle us rather than the other way around. Our deliveries are not always as we imagined or wanted. We may be left feeling disappointed, embarrassed, having failed to meet our own and others' expectations. Too often, we mothers are guilty of perpetuating this sense of inadequacy ourselves by making a fuss about our successes, earned or not. Under such pressure, prepared to the hilt, are we really any better off than our mothers? And if not, where do we turn? To stories. In the summer of 2005, we, Eleanor Henderson, and Anna Solomon, sat on the patio of the Storm Cafe in Middlebury, Vermont, overlooking Otter Creek. We'd met just days before at the Bread Loaf Writers Conference, where we were working as waiters. That night, with three other new girlfriends, we were taking a break. We talked about newly minted husbands and newly minted MFAs, and of course about books and babies. We wanted both badly, soon. But which would come first? As it turned out, our babies beat our books down the birth canal. And for a while, as we gestated, the only books at our bedsides were books about babies, what to expect when you're pregnant and in labor and beyond, what to do to soothe round ligament pain, how close your contraction should be before calling your doctor, whether you needed a bassinet or a co-sleeper, or both. Bookstores, we found, were filled with pregnancy journals and parenting Bibles, month-by-month manuals and gear guides that were little more than product catalogs. But the shelves were virtually empty of artful, entertaining, unvarnished accounts of labor and delivery. That was what we wanted, we realized. We wanted the extraordinary, the ordinary, the terrifying, the profane, and sure, the sublime, too. We wanted the truth. So Eleanor sent out a missive to her friends. How did it happen for you? Did your water break? Did you get an epidural? What did it feel like? Would you do it again? The emails came in spades and in detail. Mucus plugs, episiotomies, an entire sheet of Christmas cookies thrown up into a sick pan. These were the stories she needed to hear, and of course the friends who were writers told the best ones. The most insightful, the most reflective. The kind that invited you right into the delivery room to take a peek over the nurse's shoulder. When Anna sent along a 4-page essay about her daughter's recent birth, comic, poignant, pea-soaked, and starring Manhattan's most eccentric OBGYN, the idea occurred to us at the same time. These stories need to be collected and shared. The time seemed ripe. Was it us, or was there a new baby bump featured in the checkout line each week? The reality TV industry produced birth story after birth story, one too many for Eleanor's queasy husband. But behind the world's fascination with airbrushed bellies and dramatized labors, we sensed a more urgent narrative forming, a conversation about the choices available to mothers in the 21st century. We watched as "Why Women Still Can't Have It All" became the most circulated article in the history of The Atlantic, as Time magazine made "Are You Mom Enough?" a catchphrase, and as Mitt Romney unleashed binders full of outraged women into the Twitterverse. Ours is an era in which mothers can be CEOs, DIY homemakers, or combat soldiers with equal zeal and self-consciousness. We can be tiger mothers or attachment parents. We can argue for self-sacrifice in one breath and for selfishness in the next. We can call ourselves feminists, and we can call feminism dead. Of course, for many women across the United States and certainly across the globe, these choices are still limited, but those of us privileged enough can do and be almost anything, including paralyzed by the sheer number of possibilities. With Labor Day, we wanted to give expression to the epic questions of parenthood, fertility, marriage, work, equality, that shape the birth experience for this new generation of mothers and mothers-to-be. To our delight, the writers we approached, poets, fiction writers, memoirists, playwrights, friends and strangers alike, delivered birth stories that do exactly that and so much more. As the essays rolled in, we laughed. We wept. We groaned in recognition and gasped with surprise. Each story brought with it new struggles and new triumphs. We found ourselves as immersed in our fellow writers' birth stories as we had been in our own. It's an elemental, almost animalistic urge, the expectant mother's hunger for birth narratives. Surely our mothers and their mothers nurtured the same craving, a craving as old as storytelling or childbirth itself. The writers featured in this anthology might even suggest that pregnancy brings the privilege of a higher emotional frequency, tuning us in to the stories of other women. "I felt porous," Rachel Jameson Webster writes of her pregnancy, "strummed by the nerves of the earth. I could feel a friend who was hurting or rejoicing across the country. and I would call and drop into the moment mid-conversation. I felt connected to everyone I loved, especially to other women, and I felt, and still feel, awed to be a portal through which another would enter her life. Many of the conversations we drop in on in this book are in uncanny harmony with one another. Dani Shapiro, like Rachel Jameson Webster, feels surrounded by her ancestors as she gives birth. Anne Hood and Marie Myung-Ok Lee, both given Pitocin without permission, watch in exasperation as the items on their birth plans are derailed or just dismissed. Gina Zucker and Phoebe Damrosch bask in the triumphant pleasures of their post-labor meal. Mary Beth Keane and Eden Lepucky find themselves struggling postpartum, with lingering doubts and regrets about their long, intense labors. Noir Alsadier and Danzy Senna are both haunted by the feeling that their induced babies, now children, know they were born too early. Susan Burton and Claire Dieterer hold the details of their birth stories close, too precious to share. Ariel Greenberg and Heidi Pitlor write about the heartbreaking loss of their babies, late in pregnancy, as well as the joy of the births that followed. While we don't want to reduce them to their darkest moments, we feel it's important to note that certain details in these essays, as well as in those by Amy Herzog and Rachel Jameson Webster, might upset some new and expectant mothers. But these essays also bear witness to the extraordinary resilience of mothers and those who support them, without which the story of birth would not be complete. Other stories reflect collisions of experience and perspective. While pregnancy eases Dani Shapiro's anxiety, for Lauren Groff it brings on depression. While pushing comes as naturally as breathing to some of us, Phoebe Damrosch, Amy Brill, Anna, for others, Rachel Jameson Webster, Sarah A. Strickley, Eleanor, it requires learning to use muscles, including mental ones, we didn't know we had. Joanna Rakoff and Jane Roper must disprove the male doctors who tell them they won't have the strength or stamina to push out their babies, while Anne Hood and Heidi Julewitz make transformative connections with the people who help bring their babies into the world. For Noir Alsadier, seeing her baby's face for the first time presents a disconnect with the face she's imagined. For Lan Samantha Chang, it's instant recognition. And while Eden Lepucky and Joanna Rakoff both labor in the shadow of their mother's legendary births, one a home birth, one propulsive, Dani Shapiro and Sarah Jeffers resolve that their own births mark a departure from motherhood as they've known it. And so this book is born, a cacophonous collective baby. These true stories are as varied as the women who crafted them. Here are women of diverse cultures, races, and sexual orientations. Women in the big city and women in the country. Here are women intent on giving birth naturally, and others begging for epidurals. Women who pushed for hours and women whose labors were over practically before they'd started. Women giving birth to twins and to 10-pound babies. Here are women giving birth at home, in hospitals, in tubs, on the bathroom floor, and yes, in the car. Here are women facing agonizing complications and loss. Infertility, miscarriage, stillbirth. Here are women reveling in labor, fearing labor, defeated by labor, fulfilled by it, and always amazed by it. These stories bear no moral, espouse no single method, or dismiss any other. They simply do what great stories do best. Tell one particular experience so vividly that any listener can find herself in it. In Labor Day, true birth stories by today's best women writers, we put aside our birth plans. We don't prepare, but reflect. We remember, regret, rejoice, and reveal. We tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth. What wasn't washed away by the amnesia of oxytocin, anyway. As distinct as these 30 truths are, they are bound by the common thread of the most universal experience there is, the oldest art in the world. We hope these essays reach you with the same simple but profound sense of anticipation and celebration in which they were conceived, by a group of women sitting around a table. We might have been any women, at any time in history, sitting around a table or a quilt or a fire, dreaming about babies, telling our own stories and discovering ourselves in one another's. Eleanor Henderson and Anna Solomon, April 2014. What I'm trying to say. By Anna Solomon. Contractions started around 5 on Friday afternoon. They were mild at first, mild enough that I doubted they were real. I could walk, I did walk, around our neighborhood, thinking, am I having contractions? When Mike got home, we rented a movie and bought a box of brownie mix. And after dinner, what did we eat? I remember only the brownies. My wanting them. I mixed and baked the brownies. Later, I would wonder, what was I thinking, making brownies? But for a while then, they still tasted good to me, and I wasn't in so much pain that I couldn't enjoy the movie, too, though I don't remember what it was now, and I don't think we finished watching it. The contractions got stronger, then stayed the same through the night. Somewhere between 5 to 10 minutes apart, varying in length. I couldn't sleep, and by morning I decided I needed an epidural. I'd been unsure about the epidural question. I thought I would see what it was like, that if I could do it without, I'd rather, but that I wouldn't go crazy about it. Now I thought, I can't do it without, I need to sleep. That was my main priority, to rest, which people had told me the epidural lets you do. So we called Dr. Yang, who said she doubted I was in labor, but that sure, I could meet her at her office at 9. A word about Dr. Yang, whom other patients sometimes refer to as the Yangster, who my sister-in-law warned me was a little intense and whom I generally just call my crazy Chinese doctor. She is temperamentally similar in some ways to the Chinese grocer in our corner bodega, except that instead of yelling at me, "This is daikon!" When I called one night in my 7th month, terrified by the white, puffy flesh suddenly bulging from the part of my stomach where I imagined my baby's head to be, she yelled, "That is your colon, Anna! It's coming through the tissue! It's just abdominal separation! You have to relax!" We made the trip from Brooklyn to Tribeca, our still shiny labor ball stowed in the back seat. It was Saturday, the bridge mercifully empty. At Dr. Yang's office, we were let in by a group of Chinese construction workers, busy affixing a new door. Dr. Yang, the leader explained, would be back to meet us. She'd had to go to the hardware store for a tool. Dr. Yang is a solo practitioner, I should explain, which in her case means not only that she delivers every baby of every patient, but also oversees every hinge being fitted to her doors. We went into a room at the back and waited. I got very angry waiting. I'd been angry at Dr. Yang before, many times, but now I felt angry in the way a laboring woman feels angry. She'd abandoned me, I decided. And now, what did this portend about my labor and delivery? Would she leave as the baby was coming out to go buy a box of nails? Dr. Yang arrived some 10 minutes later. "Okay, Anna, let's see. Oh, I can see just looking at you. You're not in labor." Of course, the second she walked in the room, my contractions had diminished. After her examination, she declared, "See? You are only 50% effaced, and barely dilated, even a centimeter." I started to cry, "But I'm exhausted," I said. I did not say, "I want an epidural," because I knew now how stupid and impossible that idea was. I can't keep going. "My guess is you'll go into labor in the next day or two." "But this is labor," I told her. "Well," she said, "look, Anna, you have a very strong mind. I know this about you. You can make many things happen with your mind."
"You're saying this is all in my head?"
"What I am trying to say," this was Dr. Yang's favorite phrase, "listen, you have a very strong mind. In China, this is a very prized attribute. I can lower my blood pressure by 10 points just thinking about it. In China, people can move cups just looking at them. What I'm trying to say." As she spoke, I was vaguely aware, and disappointed and ashamed, that I wasn't in as much pain as I'd been earlier. "What I am trying to say is you're feeling your pain at a 10, and I want you to feel it at a 4.
"But I need to sleep," I said, still crying.
"Yes, exactly. You'll need to rest. Sometimes, that brings a labor on itself."
But I can't sleep, I said. It's too painful. And I am in labor, I wanted to add, but didn't. Looking back now, my wrestlings with Dr. Yang often, in my head, mostly seemed like a waste of energy. Also a symptom of my privilege. That first pregnancy, it had been so easy. We'd conceived on our first try, there had been no complications. My expectation, my assumption, was that all the important things, a beating heart, blood flow, progesterone, amniotic fluid, etc., would be just fine. Now, when I think of all that must happen in order for an embryo to be put together, to grow and thrive and be born into the world a healthy, sentient human being, my breath catches in awe and fear. I like to think that Dr. Yang, for all her eccentricities, gets that too. The miracle. And that's why she has little patience for the small stuff. Here, listen. I want you to go home. Take an Ambien. I write you out a prescription. Take the hottest bath you can stand. Drink a glass of wine. Relax. I thought pregnant women aren't supposed to take hot baths, I said. Baloney, Dr. Yang said, as she had about many other myths I'd brought up during our visits. The baby is all there. She not bothered by the heat. I explained to Dr. Yang that the one time I'd taken Ambien, 2 nights before my wedding, I'd awakened hours later on the bathroom floor. I hadn't even made it to the bed. Then take half, she cried, and ushered us out. I felt desperate on the way home. The next day or two? But at home, I followed Dr. Yang's directions, except for the wine, which I thought would make me throw up. After the bath, I got into bed. It was about 11 a.m. now, and for the next couple of hours, I managed to sleep between, though not during, contractions. It was a vague, hazy sleep. The 4 and 5 minute snatches building on one another. When I woke up and went to the bathroom, I had blood in my underwear. Dr. Yang had said, when you're in labor, you'll have blood. You'll have all sorts of things coming out of you. Hooray. It makes me flinch now. My unthinking optimism. Between this first labor and the birth of my second child, I had 3 miscarriages. All washed in blood. My friends had miscarriages too. A number of them had 3. Like me. Others gave birth to dead babies or to very sick babies. I lost my innocence, so when I went into labor the second time, if I had seen blood, I think I would have burst into tears. Instead, my water broke, clear and warm and conveniently on our all-weather deck. Mike and I looked at each other and started to laugh. I don't know if I believed in God, but it was the sort of moment where I'm tempted to. We were living in Providence, Rhode Island by then. Far from Dr. Yang, but as I readied the hospital bag, I could hear her voice, reprimanding and encouraging me. Of course that's your amniotic fluid, Anna. Don't forget the towel. It was about 2 now. From there, the contractions got steadily stronger. I rested my forearms on the ball, my knees on the floor, Mike pushing my hip bones together as we learned in class. Nothing made it less painful. But at least we were doing something, and I couldn't not be on my knees. Between contractions, I closed my eyes and rested. That was what I did best, I think, during my labor. Really rested between contractions. Not fearing the next one, but really sinking into the relief of those moments. This better be labor, I think I said a few times. And around 5, I said, we have to go to the hospital. I don't care if Dr. Yang laughs and sends us back. We're going. Mike called Dr. Yang. Dr. Yang loves Mike, and she said, well, Mike, if you really think it's different from this morning, I'll meet you at the hospital. I have another patient already there. The car ride was the worst part by far. It took us about 50 minutes across the bridge. Which one did Mike take? Through Lower Manhattan, up the West Side Highway, which is not a highway at all, but a misnamed series of traffic lights that seemed to be red every one the whole way. I was, as Mike told me later, mooing like a cow. I was grabbing at the doors, writhing to the floor. It was awful. When I was pregnant with our second child, Mike and I went for 2 contemplative childbirth preparation sessions with the warmest, loveliest doula, birth instructor, massage therapist, yoga teacher I've ever met. I learned to visualize my uterus like a jellyfish, pulsating, dancing, doing the work it needed to do. I learned to think of each contraction as an opening, my cervix a sea anemone, offering up its colorful tendrils, a releasing sort of embrace. I went from being dilated 3 centimeters to 10 in less than 30 minutes, not enough time for the epidural I vaguely asked for, and yet somehow, though the pain filled me utterly because I had a new way of thinking about it this time, the labor wasn't being done to my body. My body was doing it. I managed to feel centered, not the battered cow, but the undulating grass. The sky above, a wave out at sea. The only wave. Which is, I suppose, what Dr. Yang meant when she told me to feel my pain at a 4 instead of a 10. She meant I could think my way to a different relationship with the pain. So she was right after all, as she often was. But I was younger then, less focused, unable to listen. And she sounded so angry. In the lobby, the triage nurse didn't ask what we were doing there, but sent us up to labor and delivery. Dr. Yang was still with the other patients, so a resident examined me. I remember looking at her face, staring, willing her, thinking, if she tells me I'm only 2 centimeters dilated, I will die. I will die. I really will. Right here, I will die. But I wasn't. I was 8 centimeters dilated, entering transition, as she put it. Hooray, I thought. I'm in labor. Then I thought, and shouted, I want an epidural now! In the delivery room, the nurse told me Dr. Yang would be there soon, and that she had to get an IV in me to deliver fluid so they could do the epidural. But where's the epidural? I asked. Anesthesiology's been backed up all day, I heard her say. She couldn't have said this to me, right? Wouldn't that have been too cruel? What? It's okay, here, said the nurse, trying to get the IV in. But I was so dehydrated, the first vein she tried disappeared. And then she burst the vein in my left hand, which would be bruised for weeks, and then she couldn't get it into my right hand. Finally, she got it into my right arm. At some point in all this, I said, I have to pee. I have to go to the bathroom. And she said, you just go now. Just go. And I did. I peed all over myself. It was the first time I'd peed all over myself since I was a kid, I guess. I was just like a damn baby. I remember hearing her say at some point during this, we have pushing! And I realized I was pushing. She said, I think she's fully dilated. And I said, where is Dr. Yang? And soon Dr. Yang was there, in a brightly flowered velour dress with pink lipstick to match. And she said something to me. She actually said this, about how the residents often overestimate how dilated women are. And I thought, fuck you! Where is my epidural? Am I shitting myself? Oh shit, I might be shitting myself. And the nurse said, she's fully dilated. I really think so. And Dr. Yang checked me out and didn't confirm or not confirm this, but she said to me, Anna, if it feels better to push, you can push. 2.5 years later, a couple weeks after my second miscarriage, I stood up from a furniture store's white couch and started hemorrhaging. I went straight to Dr. Yang, telling her I'd just filled a toilet with blood, and she said, you know, Anna, even a drop of blood can look like it fills a toilet. Again, I thought, fuck you. Every nerve in my body filled with rage. If I'd had a plate, I would have thrown it. Instead, I pulled down my dark jeans, shaking, and she said, oh. Then, after she finished pulling a clot out of me, she told me she'd be right back. Ran downstairs to her sub-office apartment and gave me one of her skirts to wear on the subway ride home. I'd already been pushing, but I kept at it, and it did feel better. It felt great. I mean, it hurt like hell, but it was something to do. Not just enduring the waves of pain, but pushing. I was grunting insanely, making disgusting noises. Mike was holding one leg, Dr. Yang the other. And on her face, I remember, was total, utter joy. I said, wait, am I pushing out the baby? I really thought until that point that I was pushing because it felt better. Yes, she cried. Here, you can feel it. And I felt Sylvie's head. Oh, I'm gonna cry now. A mushy, hairy, slimy thing. With my son, there was no time to feel his somewhat less hairy head emerge. Sam's head flew out on my first push, the rest of him on my second. It was 2:03 p.m., less than 2 hours after my water had broken. At 12:28, I'd sent an email to Eleanor, telling her I might not have time to work on this anthology that day. It was as if he knew how long we'd waited for him. We named him Samuel, after the biblical Hannah's Samuel. So maybe I do believe a little bit in God. Sam was born, like any second kid, into a different family. Older, and with a child already embedded in its rhythms, and in our case, stronger for having learned resilience. We had traveled through sorrow to a place where we'd started to wonder if we really wanted another child, and then, following Sam's conception and our first glimpse of his heartbeat, me holding my hands over my eyes and peeping through my fingers, blood thrumming in my ears. An utterly joyful anticipation. When Sylvie was born, I had little idea how blessed we were, but as I labored with Sam, I was grateful in every cell of my body. I was grateful to be given another chance to push, grateful even for the pain. So grateful that as soon as I brought him to my breast, I thought, I want to do this again. That urge has since passed. And I kept pushing. And when she came out, it was 7:33 now. I'd pushed for about 25 minutes. We'd been at the hospital about an hour and a half. It was like a building erupting from me. And once it was out, over. Sylvie screamed. They brought her right to me. She had so much hair. There was a little stitching to be done, but I barely noticed. And Sylvie looked at me, found my breast, and started to suck. The next day, the pediatrician put her finger in Sylvie's mouth and said, "That's the best suck I've felt in a while." And it was true. From the beginning, Sylvie taught me how to nurse her. I haven't seen Dr. Yang in almost 3 years. I returned her skirt long ago, and I was relieved to go through my pregnancy with Sam without being yelled at by my doctor. But when we sent out Sam's birth announcement, an email came back from Dr. Yang. "It is so good to hear from you. And the great news, how was the labor? I hope it was a piece of carrot cake." What a long journey from Sylvie to Samuel. Thank you for sharing the great news. Be well. I was annoyed, at first, by her long journey comment. I'd never told her about the third miscarriage, and I wondered if she was criticizing me for taking nearly 5 years to have another child. Then I remembered her face, as she helped Sylvie into the world. Her joy. Her flowered dress so out of place in that sterile room. Her strong, thin arms handing my daughter to me. And I realized I was being silly. Dr. Yang had become as complex a presence in my life as the people I love. I did love her, I realized. So I sent her a simple email back. Thank you. It Takes a Building by Phoebe Damrosch. When I began planning my second birth, I tracked down the out-of-print children's book I had heard about, the only one I could find that depicted a home birth, to read with my toddler son. At one point, the boy in the book says about his mother, "Every few minutes, she yells so loudly the whole town will know we're having our baby today." The family in the book chops firewood in their yard. In other words, they don't live in a Brooklyn apartment building with an echoing air shaft and neighbors on all sides. If any town was going to know there was a baby on the way, it was going to be mine. This line haunted me. Friends urged nonchalance. After all, the acoustic landscape of New York City contains Mr. Softy trucks, sirens, urban chickens, rehearsing jazz musicians, endless horn honking, and marital spats. But these friends didn't live above George. For months, we had been tiptoeing around, covering every floorboard with rugs and leaving the apartment at 7 a.m. on weekends so our son wouldn't wake up Man George, thus named to distinguish him from Curious George. Man George complained when our teething baby cried at night. He banged on a ceiling in the afternoon when a tower of blocks toppled over. Once, when we overturned a bench, he bellowed so loudly we jumped. He sent emails to our landlord and the building superintendent, calling us reckless, inconsiderate, careless, and uncivilized. Looking back on it later, it was clear that man George wasn't the real source of my anxiety going into my second birth. That was a much more complex affair. I worried about how the new baby would rearrange the dynamics of our family, knowing that it would be in ways I could never prepare for, just as his brother had done before him. I worried that my first son would be heartbroken, missing my ready arms and empty lap. I worried that my house would be a wreck, that I'd never have time to get a haircut, that I'd let my kids live on buttered noodles because I would be too tired to fight about it. And I worried about the pain. Oh, Lord, the pain. When my first son was born 2 years before, on a hot summer evening in Harlem, I'd had none of these concerns and no man George to fret over. Below us lived an Italian man who made love to a series of enthusiastic women at all hours. Above us, an athletic set of 6-year-old triplets. My moaning and pacing was sure to be drowned out. I went into my first labor looking forward to it, wondering every morning whether this would be the day, going to sleep each night sure that I'd be up within hours. When the day finally arrived, 2 weeks after my due date, my husband Andre and I walked to the farmer's market and bought peaches and tomatoes, stopping to lean on park benches along the way. Contractions came and went, and I began to think this whole birth thing would be no sweat, despite the fact that I normally took an Advil at the slightest twinge of a headache. But I had also rode crew and biked across the country. I could handle this. Women had been giving birth naturally for ages. My body was made for birthing. My baby knew how to come out. These were the truths I repeated to myself in the months leading up to that first birth. Still, this was theoretical. You can read all the books, spend every weekend breathing with your partner, collect birth stories from everyone you know, but there is no way to determine what your labor will be like. After a few real contractions back at our apartment, I began to grasp the severity of my situation. I was on my hands and knees, the position I would remain in for all 5 hours of the labor, and after one really intense contraction, I lowered my head to the floor and wept, prostrating myself to the force that was quickly overtaking me. But then the next contraction came, and there was no time to be in awe. There was simply a job to be done. The pain had surprised me, but so did my labor personality. At one point, about 3 hours into active labor, when my midwife and my best friend had arrived, I decided that I had had enough. This was absurd and uncalled for, I remember thinking. If there were a customer service line to call, I would have asked to speak to a manager, and not settled for anything less than an apology and promise of retribution. I decided to push the baby out right then. My midwife, hearing me start to grunt and groan like a weightlifter, informed me that I wasn't ready yet, that I was not completely dilated. I didn't care. I wanted the baby out. Sensing that I was determined, she offered to do a midwife trick and give my cervix a little help during the next contraction. Our baby arrived soon after this in a tub in the kitchen. If I didn't have pictures, the memories might have been even more scattered. The towels warming in the oven, the placenta bobbing around in the salad spinner bowl, eating bagels and farmer's market tomatoes on our couch with a 2-hour-old baby on a pillow between us. My first son was born on a Saturday night, and Monday morning I returned some books to the library, feeling ecstatic and capable of anything. After that labor, I was a superhero, a delusion I would wish on every new mother. But not everyone was as satisfied as I was. I had a friend who told me I had been selfish to have my baby at home, to put my son in danger for my own comfort. When you choose a home birth, defending yourself against comments like these becomes part of the experience. Sometimes it helps to have statistics in your back pocket, like the fact that a planned, low-risk home birth is as safe as a hospital birth, according to a large 2009 study published in the Canadian Medical Association Journal. But fact-checking aside, my friend's comment struck me as sad. As if the birth had only been about producing a healthy baby. That was incredibly important to me, of course, but so was producing a healthy, confident mother. So was allowing my son to come when he was ready. So was bringing him into our lives in the most intimate, loving, safe place we could. So was knowing that he was held from the moment he was born in the gentlest and most familiar hands. So was answering every cry, changing every diaper, finding our own answer to every question. Many women want these things for their births, but it is not always possible in a hospital with a clock ticking and so many rules to follow. One hospital in my area is nearing a 50% cesarean rate. For me, a cesarean was something very real to avoid, partly because I didn't want to recover from major surgery while caring for an infant, and partly because I was concerned about the safety of myself and my child. The CDC reports that cesareans triple the risk of neonatal death, not to mention higher rates of life-threatening infections for the baby and mother, increased chances of uterine rupture in later pregnancies, increased allergies in babies, and the list goes on. But I didn't say these things to my friend, nor could I say them to most of the mothers I knew. To raise questions about why they were being induced or pushed into C-sections somehow came across as critical of them as mothers, which was the last thing I meant. What I meant is that all mothers deserve a beautiful birth. All babies deserve it. All families deserve it. There is so much that goes unsaid. For example, I always thought that pregnancy, birth, and caring for a new baby were all part of a continuum or trajectory. But they were three totally separate experiences. Both of my pregnancies feel so personal that even now I don't think of myself as having been pregnant with either of my sons. I was just me, pregnant. Birth was an intense, painful, infuriating, challenging metamorphosis. But again, it was my own. And then there were my delicious boys with their dark eyes, wrinkled brows, and tiny, eager hands. Home birth brought the seams of those experiences close, but they remained three distinct pieces of a whole for me. When it came time to prepare for my second birth, I had thought a lot about my first experience and decided that what I needed to do to make it less rushed and more enjoyable for everyone was to cultivate a more go-with-the-flow attitude. I did hypnobirthing training, learning to cue myself into a meditative, trance-like state in which I would allow birth to wash over me. I bought candles, lavender oil, and New Age music, with lots of tinkling chimes. Not my usual style. When the time came, I had only to lie on the bed, close my eyes, and allow my baby to come. Man George would never even know. And yet, as I lay meditating in preparation, I couldn't shake my uneasy feeling. I still had to get from one side of the unknown to the other. I also had a dark secret that I can now reveal because it turned out to be laughable. I was absolutely certain that I would never love my second child as much as my first, though I promised myself that he would never know. How little did I know about love? Of course I would not feel about this tiny larva of a newborn as I did about the person I had spent the last 2 years falling in love with, but I would. My capacity to love and my capacity to withstand pain both surprised me. Withstanding pain should not be confused with welcoming it. On the day of the labor, guess who showed up? That bitch from the last birth. Except this time, she was a little whiny too. Why does it have to be this way? I moaned to my midwife and my mom, who had driven down from Vermont on my due date, 5 days before. Every time I found a position that felt more comfortable, buoyed in the tub, lying back in the rocking chair, my midwife shook her head apologetically. The baby was lounging over on one side of my belly in what my husband referred to as a gangsta lean. Our task was to get him to move toward the center, with his spine in line with my belly button. "It's okay to take a break," she told me, again and again, "but when you are feeling brave, you need to get up and walk." I was not feeling brave. I was feeling pissed off. By then, my midwife knew me well. During the prenatal home visits, I lay on my bed as she listened to the heartbeat, and then held the stethoscope to my ears so that I could hear. My son played with the measuring tape while we talked, sometimes for close to an hour, about various things that were often related to pregnancy. All the medical stuff, but also good recipes for iron, how to handle my older son during the birth, my husband's role in the labor, what attachments we needed to connect a hose to our bathroom sink. Just before 9 p.m. on another hot August night, it was time. We had had good luck getting the baby to shift over by having me lie on my opposite side, and it was while I was in that position that my midwife informed me that if I wanted to have a water birth, I needed to get into the tub pretty quickly. I was not about to move, so I began pushing right where I was, on the bed my father had built. When I say that I began pushing, I simply mean that the contractions changed from being waves that I withstood to being surges that urged my body to bear down. Each contraction was a paradox, simultaneous passivity and activity. I was powerless to the force and rhythm of them, and yet each asked something different of me, from subtle shifts in breathing and posture in early labor to primal moaning and swaying in active labor, to the final stage in which every cell in my body felt that it was being called on to push. I can't imagine what I would have said to my husband if he had yelled, "Push!" like they do in the movies. It would be like yelling, "Sneeze!" to someone clearly about to. The baby was inching down the birth canal, and despite my better judgment, I was making that happen. When I look back on the final few minutes of the birth, I remember the ridiculousness of having a head in my vagina, that famous birthing ring of fire, the slippery wriggle that followed, and then the relief. And a baby. Where did he come from? While I showered, rubbing my doughy belly and feeling blissfully autonomous, my mother went downstairs to check on my older son, who was asleep at his friend's apartment on the first floor of our building. She found him awake and excited to meet his new brother. As soon as he entered our bedroom, he climbed into my lap, the giant that he now was in comparison. This is the child who never stops speaking, from the moment he wakes up to the moment his head hits the pillow. But in that moment, he was dumbstruck. He pointed and grinned and pointed again. He watched silently from my lap while our midwife weighed the baby in a red polka-dotted sling, hooked up to a scale. 9 pounds even. And then, when she had finished and his new brother was swaddled and resting, he uttered his first comment. "Let's take the baby to the museum." Later, I would wonder whether he meant for us to leave him there, but I think his motives were pure. We take all of our favorite house guests to the Brooklyn Museum, across the street. Just as Andre poured glasses of champagne for everyone, our midwife's beeper went off, letting her know that another mother was going into labor. She packed up her tub and wheeled it out. She'd call the next day and come back in 3 days. One boy fell asleep on our bed, another rocked in my mother's arms a few feet away. It was nearly 11 p.m. and I was starving. Andre lit some candles at our dining room table and put a few pillows on a chair for me. We raised our glasses to a job well done, to our new baby, to our growing family. And then we raised them to man George. While I'd been laboring, he'd been cooking rice and beans, conch and fried plantains. He'd put the food into matching casserole dishes on a painted tray and delivered it to Andre, sometime in the early evening, though I'd been too deep in my labor fog to notice. George would give us a few weeks before he started banging on the ceiling again. Tomorrow, we would wake up in our own beds, and there would be coffee. And a baby to begin to love. 3. By Heidi Pitlor. A few years ago, when I carted my two babies around the grocery store or Target, people regularly approached us and asked me whether I'd had help conceiving them. Each time, I responded, with a mix of irritation, on behalf of the many people who need infertility treatments and dumb, misplaced pride. No, twins run in my family. My grandmother was a twin. Not that it's any of your business. I never laid out the whole story to these curious strangers, of course. I did not say that although I was lucky enough not to have needed infertility treatments, I did experience a terrible miscarriage not long before I conceived the twins. I had been 6 months pregnant with a boy. One September night, excruciating pains shot through my lower abdomen, as if bricks were pressing into me from every angle. The pain continued on and off, though mostly on, for a week. A week of many ultrasounds, all normal, and visits to doctors. "It's normal, just ligament stretching," one said. "Buck up. Pregnancy hurts," another doctor told me, a man to whom I nearly replied, "Did yours hurt?" A week of nearly no sleep, a week of fear and horrible cramping and pain, and a growing sense that this pain was anything but normal. And then one morning, nothing. No pain, no burps or kicks from within. No movement at all, except a slight, almost peaceful floating sensation, as if a heavy water balloon were sloshing back and forth inside of me. Strange, I thought. But at least the pain had gone. The next day, at a regularly scheduled checkup, I lay on the examining table while my midwife dragged a fetal Doppler around and across the small hill of my abdomen to measure the baby's heartbeat. She tapped the end of the microphone and tried again. At last, she looked at me kindly and shook her head. "I'll go get the ultrasound ready," she said. She touched my arm and left the room. I lay there, alone, for about 5 minutes, staring up at stickers of ducks waddling across the ceiling. These pudgy, smiling ducks meant to comfort women as they got pap smears or pelvic exams. I glanced over at a poster mapping out the stages of fetal growth. I finally looked down at my belly and immediately closed my eyes. My heart thudded. The midwife reappeared and walked me down a hallway to a closet-sized room with an ultrasound machine. Here, that unsympathetic male doctor tried and failed to find a baby's heartbeat. "It's gone," he said. And the midwife took my hand. Back in the exam room, I called my husband, who, bless him, came within minutes. We held each other, utterly at a loss for words, and soon after met with another doctor who asked me to decide whether I wanted to deliver the baby or have a DNC, dilation and curettage, to remove the baby. "Think about it," she said, handing me a rose-colored pamphlet. She told me that most people choose to deliver so that they can hold their baby one last time. "It helps you understand that you really were a mother." But I had a friend who had lost a baby even further along in her pregnancy. She had labored and delivered in the maternity ward of a hospital, where a dozen balloons were mistakenly delivered to her room and then whisked away. Babies wailed up and down the hallway. New grandparents peered in her room, asking if she knew where their daughter was. "No, thank you," I decided right then, no labor and delivery for me. "Are you sure? Certain?" "Yes, please," I said again and again. "I'm sorry, but I'm clear about my choice." I never wavered. I felt quite sure that I had been and still was, in some unnameable way, a mother. The doctor explained the procedure for the DNC. I would be induced within a few days, and the surgery would take place a few days after that. So, for more than 5 days, I would carry this baby boy within me. For 5 days, I would continue to appear pregnant. I was more than a little nervous. The strange thing was that these 5 days, while heartbreaking, were also a sort of gift. I had the chance to hold him inside me just a little while longer. Just me and him. A 5-day-long goodbye. I was prescribed antibiotics, which caused me to vomit in the parking lot of my doctor's office. The next day, the doctor inserted 20 dilators, what felt like toothpicks, into my cervix. The following day brought 20 more, and we waited for me to begin to dilate. The next day, we drove to the hospital, and I was wheeled to a waiting area far from the maternity ward. A nurse asked if I would like a priest to be present before or after the procedure. I declined and said, "I'm Jewish, sort of," meaning that it had been a long time since I had gone to temple. I was given a general anesthetic, and the surgery was performed. When I woke, a group was standing before me. My husband, my doctor, a nurse, and a smiling woman wearing a large maroon and orange hat and a red patchwork pantsuit that for some reason made me think of Mumenschans. My doctor appeared excited. "She's a rabbi," my doctor said, gesturing to the woman. "We found her in the hallway."
"Would you like to sing a song?"
the rabbi asked, and too groggy to do much more, I shook my head, said thank you anyway, and passed out again. When I woke again, the rabbi had left. My doctor told me that the surgery had gone well and that, as requested, the baby had been wrapped inside a blanket that we had brought for him, a soft yellow blanket that my aunt had recently given us. Legally, we were required to name him and make burial arrangements. He was given a death certificate, though no birth certificate, and cremated.
We decided to spread his ashes in the ocean and planted a small white fringe tree in our backyard in his memory. It blooms only in June, and for only a few weeks. But it makes its presence known with its strong smell of honeysuckle and delicate but dense, almost hair-like, white foliage. Grief. Long, October days of eating blueberry muffins and reading trashy magazines and crying. My stomach shrank to its previous size. I had been told how to handle lactation if it occurred, but fortunately it never did. I missed my boy. I saw him everywhere still in the faces of small boys on the street, in the few items of clothing we had received as early gifts, in the ultrasound photos of him that we had been given while he was alive. Friends and family visited, and probably because of their generous sympathy and love, I let myself fall apart. But I was 36, and this had been my first pregnancy. I knew I wanted more than one child, and time did not stop. We had to start to try again soon. I was not emotionally ready, nor was my husband. Still, according to the laws of biology and the advice of my doctor, we really had to try. During the autopsy, tiny blood clots had been found in our baby. This may or may not have been the cause of death, but I was assigned a doctor for high-risk pregnancies. He suggested if and when I did conceive again, I take shots of Lovenox, a blood thinner, each day as a precaution. It couldn't hurt, the doctor said. My husband and I went back to work. Christmas and Hanukkah came. We traveled to the Berkshires and in February up to Stowe, Vermont. We tried again to conceive, nervously, obediently, and one winter morning the pregnancy stick showed a positive. We were happy, a little. Looking down at that white stick with the pink stripe, I said to my husband, I'll be really happy when I'm holding a baby. After 6 or 7 weeks, we went back to my OBGYN's office for our first checkup. I'd had some spotting and assumed the worst, so back in the ultrasound room, with the same midwife I went. But this time, there was no unsympathetic doctor and my husband was with me. The ultrasound technician flicked on the monitor and squirted gel across my stomach. All eyes, except mine, turned to the screen. The midwife gasped, and my immediate thought, the baby is gone. Someone said, two. And my husband's eyes ballooned. Twins! Nurses and midwives rushed into the room. Someone said, it's a miracle! Someone else added, bless Jesus! And I laughed, I think, and swallowed hard because now I could lose two babies. It's unbelievable.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.